We are in the lovely home of Casey and Ruth Rowley in Londonderry, Vermont. They are lifelong residents of this community and have been lifelong contributors to this community in many, many ways. And we also have their lovely daughter, Susie, with us today. So we have many, many stories to tell. Welcome to Out of the Hills. And Casey, tell me a little bit. We visited last night, and there's going to be so much to tell. But your family originally came up from Manchester, and you came to what is now known as the Bromley Farm in Peru. And tell me a little bit about that.
Well, I was only 6 years old when we moved from Manchester to Peru, and I went to my first year of school in Peru at the little church, not the little schoolhouse, I should say, up on the hill there. And my recollection was I had a lady as a teacher, Miss Johnson, whom turned out to be somehow related to me because she married my cousin.
Huh.
And so we moved.
So you were the star student.
Oh yes, I was top shelf.
Then
we moved from Peru down to the Taylor Farm. It was owned by Bill and Marion Taylor at the time, and my father ran the farm and the associates there with it for, I don't know, probably a year or two. And I then went to the school in Londonderry, which again was walking from the farm to the school and the back of home. So it was kind of hard going. There was no school buses and such in those days. And from the, what is now the Taylor Farm, to a place called Harrington's Home, just this side of the dump here in Londonderry.
And that was Bob's water mill for a while and is now the quilt shop.
That's correct. And then my dad got a job over in the Springfield shops, which of course was wartime by then. And after, I think we were only at the Harrington property maybe, I don't know, a couple of years. And then we moved down on the main street, so to speak, here in North Londonderry. At that time was called the Vigue property. And we were there for 2 or 3 years. Seems like we moved an awful lot, but I didn't remember all that. And then we moved to the home right at the north end of the Middletown Road. And there we stayed until my folks both passed away. And I had stayed there and with them, and then I in turn bought the property myself.
How would you describe the economy of this area back in those days?
Oh boy, I'll tell you, at that time there was nothing, so to speak, except farming, which of course was a lot. There was a lot of farms back there then, and everything else was pretty low.
Logging, sawmills.
That's it. That was about all there was.
Yeah.
And then the shops really were booming, and so during the war, and there was a lot of employment there.
So that everybody was going over to Springfield for...
That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was a big movement with the shops.
Now, how did you meet Ruth? I hear these wonderful stories. Ruth lived up in
Weston.
Ruth...
Ruthie.
Was a Holton. And how did you guys meet?
Well, back then there was a hall, a big, pretty good sized building, right on the beginning of the road to Weston. And every Saturday night they'd have a square dance there. And it was a big thing. Boy, a lot of people would come to the square dances and they would dance. And this one particular night, I got the courage somehow and I walked across the hall and asked Ruthie to dance. And I don't know what year that was, but we've been married over 65 years, so it was a little while ago.
That's wonderful. And Ruthie tells how you would walk from Londonderry up Hellspeak Road and Holden Hill Road.
To the farm.
Of course, Hellspeak Road is road now. Back then, it stopped at the Hazleton farm.
Uh-huh.
And there was just a little walk trail that went all the way through the woods up to the Holden property.
Yeah.
And I had lots of courage during the daytime to walk up through there, but coming home at night,
pretty dark.
There was an awful lot of strange
bears.
I didn't care for. And I could run where I could run, and I had to walk the rest of the way, and I was scared right to death. But anyways, that was quite an experience.
And Ruthie, your family was a dairy farm family as well, right?
Yes.
And there were 8 children in your...
Yes, there were.
Yeah? And where were you in age order?
Oh, I was
order?
Number 6 down the way.
Almost the baby.
Yeah.
Yeah? And do you still have... Are there still Holtons in the... our community?
There's 3 of us still alive.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Her sister Louise.
My sister Louise. And
her brother Roger.
Ew.
Who lives in Colorado.
And Louise, Lyle, and I. Just 3 of us.
Did nice. I say Lyle?
Nice.
You said Roger.
Oh, I meant Lyle, not Roger.
And then, what year were you married?
1949. Mm-hmm.
48. Well, I was born in 1950.
Yeah,
49.
Yeah.
And they were too young to get married in the state, so their parents had to take them to Maryland over the line to get married because they were underage.
It was some line. We went all the way to Baltimore, Maryland.
That was the closest.
Yes.
Well, there was a place there that didn't require a time wait for licenses, marriage licenses and such. And so when we got there, we found out they just discontinued that. So we had to stay there in Baltimore for a while before we could get married anyway.
Oh, Lordy.
I think that was with Grandpa and Grandma and your sister?
My sister and her husband, Lyle DeLong.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
well, it's a testament that you've been married all these years.
And Mom said that when they were first married, my father went off and left her and went hunting. 65 years later, he still goes off and leaves her alone and goes hunting.
So, hunting is one of your passions. I know we tried to set up an interview last week, and you were in Michigan, I think, goose hunting?
Missouri.
Yes, goose hunting.
Hunting turkeys out
turkey
there.
Turkeys.
We don't have enough turkeys here?
Oh, yeah, but there's more there.
Yeah.
I enjoyed that out there. I have a friend that has a farm that has 2,000 acres on it, and so he supplies us with 4-wheelers, and we go out hunting on his property there. It's a wonderful time.
Can I go with you next time?
No. No, but...
So go back, tell me a little bit more about the economy here. What we're building up to is you eventually became very involved with Stratton Mountain.
True.
And but tell me a little bit about the opportunities here. You got involved with Magic Mountain in the early days?
Yes. Before that, I worked for a construction company called Perini Corporation. And when I got done for them, it was about at the time that Magic Mountain was starting to get started. And
that was the Thorner family.
Yes, and so I had a friend, Leroy Williams, that had a construction company, and I asked him for a job, and he gave me a job driving truck at the very beginning, hauling material for the sewage system at Magic. And I stayed there and organized the patrol for them. Hans Thorner, whom was the owner, hired me to stay on and organize and direct the ski patrol there the very first year. And that turned out to be quite a fiasco. The lift burnt down and we had to
tragic magic.
Had to rebuild it in the middle of winter, which was some joke. But anyways, in the process of my rebuilding it, Stratton allowed to come over with one of their big tractors and put some of the lift stuff back into place, and a lot of help for us. It was really a big thing. And I thought, boy, this company over there at Stratton, if they do things like that, it might be fun to work for them. So I went over there and applied for a job and told them my background. And they were quite enthusiastic to hire me. So they hired me, and unbeknownst to me, they gave me a crew of men to start out working in. We did everything from the first job I had there at Stratton was clearing a huge acreage, which is now a lake, in the middle of a golf course. And we started there because they were going to have that as a lagoon for the sewage system, which didn't turn out. And then they had to make another area for the lagoon, which didn't turn out. So for the third time, we made one that they used. And then my crew was involved in clear-cutting the trails from the bottom of the mountain to the top. And we did that for about 2 years.
So this was probably 1962, 63, would you say, that you started at?
No, it was before that. I believe it was 60, 61.
Okay.
Long in there.
And who were the names that were behind the mountain at that point? Dick and Tink Smith?
Oh, yeah, Dick and Tink. They were the organizers of a lot of it. And a man by the name of Frank Snyder, who was from Connecticut.
From Greenwich.
Had an inspiration to come in and help. He was president of the Moore & Munger Company, a very, very prominent company. Wax was their main business. And between the three of them, they got together and organized a committee, so to speak, on how to go ahead and get the ski area started. All the property there at Stratton was owned, the whole bottom part of the mountain was owned by International Paper Company. And their policy was they didn't sell any of their property. They kept their property for production of trees and such. And anyway, the Smith boys they had a big mill of their own, and so they had done business with International Paper for quite a number of years. And so they made a deal with International to swap a parcel of the Smith property for timber with the International Company. And therefore, they gained acquisition of most of the mountain, except for a little bit at the top, which was owned by the St. Regis Paper Company. And that acquired, that's how everything acquired to get started with Stratton. And from there, we went on to build everything from A to Z. And like I said, I was in charge of the cutting of the trees and such. And then,
now, what do you suppose initiated this craze of skiing in this area? We went from a downtrodden, you know, poor economy to all of a sudden all this interest in. We had Bromley Mountain was established in the 30s, and then Magic, and then Stratton, which really dramatically changed the entire area.
Well, my knowledge of the Stratton setup, the intuition of the mountain and the way it was set up. Frank Snyder, he and his wife Jessie were avid skiers, both cross country and downhill. And they always would travel from Connecticut clear up to Stowe and places like that. It was a horrible long drive. And so they decided on the way one time going back home that they saw Stratton Mountain sticking up there, and they said, boy, that might make a good ski area. So that was the inspiration that got it started. And it rather carried on and developed from there, and that's how Snyder became involved with the Smith guys and commenced with all the building.
I mean, the idea of the Smiths were just loggers and sawmill operators.
That's right.
For them to get into the whole.
I don't think they even skied, did they?
No. Not to my knowledge, they never did.
But they saw opportunity.
They did.
Oh, yes, they did.
Yeah, Tink was a very wise man, and so was Dick.
Yeah.
There was a lot of ups and downs of that business in those days. And
sure.
We built the first three lifts and got them operating in 1 year from the commencement of it. And that was a big job. And I remember we were sitting by a barrel full of scrap lumber, the smoke and stink coming out of it, and sitting down. Somebody had come up with a few bottles of beer, and we were sitting on the ground. It was real cold. And one of the guys said, well, we've got a bill. I wonder if anybody will come. I thought that was quite a comment, but they sure did come.
Yeah.
And sure did come.
The first year, we had the access road pretty much laid out, and it was fine when it was frozen.
Yeah.
But when the spring skiing come, it wasn't frozen, and the mud was knee-deep and just awful.
And it was it 1965 that it opened for the first time?
No, before that, 62.
Oh, that early?
Yeah.
63.
Yeah, 62, 63.
But the access road would be knee-deep. People would bury their cars.
And Tink was down there. Tink Smith was down there running one of the big bulldozers.
Pulling people out.
Yeah, and he hooked onto a guy that was a very prominent person from Albany, New York. Forget his name, but I knew it. And he let the clutch out on the tractor, and away he went, but he only had the bumper. He didn't have the rest of the So we called him.
He was in trouble.
We called him Tink Bumper after that for a while. And that was just, but the guy in the car said, you know, I'm telling you something, if I can get that car up here again tomorrow, I'll be back.
Oh, that's great.
So that was the inspiration back then, those days.
Yeah.
It was really a lot of fun.
So during the winter, you were largely on the ski patrol. And during the summer, you'd be involved in, you were sort of mountain manager.
I was, and also
I
went from the ski patrol, and it happened to be that I was one of the few people that were involved in the place that actually played golf.
Yeah.
And I'm not very good, but I played. And Tink and I think Dick primarily wanted to build a golf course because they both liked to play golf. And so they designated an area, and they got a fellow by the name of Jeffrey Cornish was the architect, and they had him come in and lay out the thing. So we had to clear all the fairways and such down there, and after they really got things opened up and all, I said, well, you're going to have somebody take care of the golf course. He said, yeah. And I had no idea that they'd want me there, but I asked if I could have the job of taking care of the golf course. I didn't know anything about taking care of a golf course. And it turned out they gave me the job. And
the vision of all this is what is amazing to me. I mean, one thing to establish the ski area, but then they recognized that they needed something in the summer.
Yes.
And one of the nice things that we mentioned last night as we were talking, that they made a real effort to employ people from the local community,
right,
which was so important because it built community support, and it also mm-hmm. generated huge revenue for this destitute area.
I had some local men that about all they'd ever done was cut logs and such, and of course it was kind of in the early days of the chainsaws too, and they were great big heavy things, you know, and these guys would come in there and saw with those saws 10, 11 hours a day. Oh, just hard work. And I loved it. We all had a good time.
Yeah.
We played different tricks with the saws. It was good fun.
We talked about you were a good man if you could run 5 gallons of gas through his saw in a day.
Right.
That's a lot of work.
I was a real good man, yeah. Of course, back then, the saws used a lot more gas.
Right, so. Right. Yeah, yeah. Yes. Now, as a consequence of your employment there, Susie virtually grew up on skis.
I did.
And Ruthie was invaluable in the ski school and the GIST program. Tell me a little bit about the ski school and the program there, what you were involved with.
Well, I worked in the...
You taught me how to ski.
Oh, you're kidding.
I kid you not.
That was a long time ago. My primary thoughts in life was children. I loved being with children and teaching them. And so I ran a children's ski school at Stratton, and it was more fun. And we had children galore come in there to take lessons and so on.
And you had some famous children.
Yeah, I taught Caroline Kennedy and Courtney and many others, and whom I've forgotten the names of. But children were my people. I enjoyed them so much, and communicating with them. They were so much fun to be with. And
you were telling me about Caroline getting to the top of the mountain and falling and having a broken ski. And
yeah, they were, Caroline and Courtney were going up the chairlift one day and giggling, teeing, and crisscrossing their skis and so on. And well, so they get to the top of the mountain and they had to get off, and their skis are all crisscross. Well, they jumped off, and Caroline Kennedy ski was broken. And
lucky she didn't break a leg.
Yes, it is. And
that's right.
But just the ski was broken, thank God. And So I told Jackie Kennedy about it, and you know, told them how much fun they were to teach and so on, and she said, and how they had that little accident happen. She says, well, they should have been paying attention. And I want to say you're right.
And you didn't, though.
But no, you're careful what you say to those people. But I did enjoy teaching children there, and I taught many, many children there.
So was Susie right out? I mean, that was built-in daycare. Susie was probably right with you.
Oh, yeah, Susie.
When did you start skiing, Susie?
I started it when I was 5. We started at Bromley. My mother cleaned the restrooms for me to get free skiing. And my cousin, Scott Howe, who came with me, and we were always together. And my parents made me take lessons every weekend so I could be a better skier. Then we left Bromley after a few years. Dad worked on the ski patrol. And as he said, we went to Magic. And I just skied. They worked. And then we went to Stratton, and that was our home.
Stratton was the place.
I was still in high school at Burton, and when I graduated from Burton, I went to Stratton and worked for 15 years. 10 years in the ski school and for my mother, and 5 for my dad on the ski patrol. I think it was the best years of my life. Yeah, you knew everybody, and all my
It was a real sense
there.
Of community up
yeah.
there.
We don't like that.
We've lost that to some degree.
Yeah, we've lost that
as it's gotten larger and larger. You had the best years there.
I sure did.
Yeah, she did.
I'll never forget.
We did.
And one of the things to go along with what Ruthie said, I usually had to work out of the top of the mountain because that was our control place for the ski patrol. And I was up there, and the radio went on, and they said, Casey, there's a guy down here with a felt hat on and a long coat and low shoes chasing a little guy down the mountain. I said, have you been drinking? And he said, don't be funny. So I went peeling down there, and sure enough.
On your skis.
On my skis. And sure enough, here was this guy following this little guy down the mountain, falling down, having a frightful time. And I said to him, what in the world are you doing? And he said, I got to keep track of that little guy. I didn't know that anybody of the Kennedys was there or anything, but this was little John Kennedy. And he was a little different. But this guy was a Secret Service guy. It was his job to keep up with John.
And he couldn't ski.
So I helped him get down to my office at the bottom of the mountain there, and we went in, and I got him a big old warm jacket and warm boots and some warm pants and turned him loose. And boy, you never saw a happier man in your life.
You made his day.
Made his day, because he was never going to make it through the day the way he was.
Oh, jeez.
So that was just one of the things that are very interesting.
Think of the many famous people that went through that mountain.
Yes.
That
yeah, right.
You,
yes.
Some of whom you knew and some not.
I know. There was another time when there was a car accident. In those days, there was not any rescue squad or anybody that was available to go. And so normally when there was anything that was fairly close by, they'd call us on the mountain. They called me to this bad wreck was down in Bonneville. And I went down there, and there was a man and his wife that was in one car, and a man alone in another car. And there was another car with 2 people in it, was pretty badly banged up. So anyway, the car with the man and the wife in it, I had Bob Hunt take care. I told him I'm going to have Bob Hunt take care of him while I went to the other car and helped that man. And come to find out, the couple that Bob Hunt was taking care of was the man that was the president of the Good Humor, not Good Humor.
Friendly's
Ice Cream, yeah.
Yeah.
Friendly's Ice Cream.
Yeah.
And he was a wonderful man. Banged up pretty bad, but he was so happy that after he got out of the hospital, he came in his work clothes, of course, coat and tie and all that, you know. And I didn't have a clue. He said, head was all bandaged up. I didn't have a clue. And he said, you don't remember me? I said, no, I guess I don't. Well, he said, you were very kind to me and did a good job. So he gave me a year's supply of Friendly's hamburgers and french fries. I never ate so many french fries and hamburgers.
You got your money's worth on that.
Oh, yeah. My word. They're frightful.
Now, speaking of the rescue squad and whatnot, you were instrumental in starting the Otis Clinic on the mountain.
Right.
Tell me a little bit about that.
That was an interesting thing. We didn't have any money that was allotted for the clinic, and the clinic has always been separate from the Stratton Corporation, and so it was strictly a nonprofit organization. And we had a man, Frank Snyder's brother, Phil Snyder, was very, very instrumental in the clinic, and he donated. No, he didn't donate. He allotted, I forget how many thousands of dollars to get the clinic going and keep it going. And of course, he was pretty concerned that we were going to lose it, and he would be out all his money. But it turned out it was very successful. It still is very successful. We had a situation there at the clinic that was rather unique. We'd have orthopedic surgeons come from different parts of the country, and they'd come and donate their time, and we'd give them skiing privileges and help them with their lodging and that sort of thing. And that worked as a real good swap situation. People loved it, and they'd sign up and come back every year.
Yeah. Now, I remember my father was a doctor, and he got a season's pass for providing services to the mountain. To have a doctor on the slopes was...
Yes, was worthwhile.
And then on the chalkboard at the top of the lift attendant would write little signs, and it would say, "Doctor, go to clinic."
Yes, yeah.
There wasn't too much communication then.
Now we have cell phones and walkie-talkies.
It was a wonderful thing to have that kind of service right at the bottom of the mountain.
Yeah.
Because we used to have to take people to the doctor or have them go to the doctor in a Volkswagen Beetle with a broken leg. Have you ever tried to put anybody in a Beetle with a broken leg? It was a trick, I mean.
Now, another interesting aspect of the mountains in this area, nobody around here knew how to ski. Mm-hmm. So we imported a lot of Austrians, many of whom are still in the community.
That's correct.
So the mountains really became a sort of an international, very, very wonderful, the number of people. Stefan Scherenthaler is still a good friend of mine.
Hubert Schriebel.
And talk a little bit about that. Was that fun, having all these wild Austrians? I know they had the Stratton Mountain Boys. And,
yes.
Made the mountain a very fun, congenial place.
Oh, sure did. And there again, it rubbed myself and some of my people the wrong way to have all these people going around jabbering, and we didn't have a clue what they were talking about, you know? And so I used to argue with Amo all the time about, can't you have these people speak English? Well, little by little, they learned. And little by little, we got a good rapport together.
You probably learned a little German.
Yeah,
well, a little, not much, I'm sure. But I thoroughly enjoyed those boys, and they were really much fun to listen to their music. And
wonderful people.
They were so full of life, you know. Really, it was
quite
an area to go through.
You talked about, I mean, you almost lived on the mountain. Ruthie was talking last night about almost having to beg you to come home for a night at home because you were so engaged socially.
Yeah,
so
people always wanted us to go with them to dinner, and it was real fun, but busy life, my word.
One time they did live in, believe it or not, they lived in one of Dad's offices on the mountain for a while.
Slept on the floor.
I would get mad at him and stay with my grandmother.
We actually ended up renting a place right on the lower tail hill there that was super for Ruthie. She could just go out and stand by the road, and people would stop and pick her up and bring her up to the mountain. And I would usually go before she did, so they didn't have any transportation.
Yeah. Now, Ruthie, you have a beautiful photograph. Can we show that to the camera a little bit? This is a picture of you. And it says on the back here, I didn't even realize, but it says 1987, last year at Stratton.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a wonderful shot.
We met so many nice people at Stratton who became our friends as of today. And I just loved teaching children. They were my people and fun to be with. And the children have no fear, or hardly any. And they were fun to teach. And I taught Caroline Kennedy after the assassination of her dad. They came to Stratton. Jackie brought the children. And I had a wonderful time with the kids and teaching them the days they were there.
Now, did you both retire about the same time from the...
I think so, yeah, well, from Stratton.
Well, I left Stratton in 84 to go down and start up Haystack. And I don't think you left until a while after that, as I recall.
This says 87 on the photograph.
Yeah.
That's probably about right.
Yeah.
Yep. Dad had a bad car accident driving to work. And Mom had to stop working.
To take care of him?
Take care of him, yeah.
That must have been 87.
Yeah, I think it was. Because it was when you had the accident, Mom stopped.
Mm-hmm. Guy ran into me going to work, and his truck flew into the air and landed right on top of my truck and squashed me in the cab, and
oof.
I was pretty well broke up.
Wow.
They rushed me to Rutland and put me to be back together again.
Now, what precipitated the change from Stratton to Haystack?
I didn't care for the people that bought
Stratton.
And so I probably used bad judgment, but I left and went down there and helped resurrect Haystack with the man that was not the original, but one of the presidents of Stratton, Don Taranelli. And he asked me to come down there, and so I said, I did, you know, and make kind of a long story short, it was a good time there, too. I enjoyed getting things going and helping lay out the mountain and things like that.
I love all of your stories, because it seems like so much of it was just you happened to be at the right place at the right time.
That's exactly right.
And you fell into these opportunities. You mentioned last night you never even went to college. You graduated from Green Mountain in Chester.
Right.
And just fell into these wonderful opportunities.
It was just called Chester High School back then.
Uh-huh.
I wasn't Green Mountain, but
yeah,
that's true. And I believe I was extremely fortunate, very lucky, you might say, too, of being able to fall into these particular positions, which I don't know that you could really do that today, because they want people with all kinds of pedigree to get in to do these jobs and that sort of thing.
Right, right.
It's a different world.
But yeah.
I enjoyed it.
Yeah. Well, so much of it was your personality and your, all of you,
yeah,
you know, are so involved in the community and...
That's all we had was the ski industry, you know, pretty much. I mean, that's all we had in our area. So we had to that or farming or...
Back to the...
jobs.
Remember back to the very beginning, we had to learn to ski the same way the Austrians learned to ski, so we wouldn't look like dummy scum. And that was very difficult, because it was a completely different style that we had to learn to ski in.
You had learned at Bromley, and that was...
That's different, yeah. It was a lot different. Gene Gillis was our principal instructor, and he was a mountain manager at that time, and boy, we finally got it, but we climbed up and skied up. This was before the lifts we even started on, which was hard going.
What's one of the most memorable stories from Stratton? An experience you had there, good or bad?
Well, we sure had a lot of stories, I can tell you that.
Susie, do you remember some particular event that sticks out in your mind, some celebration or?
Yeah, I remember when we had the, I guess it was called the U.S. Open.
The World Cup.
World Cup. That was the greatest. I mean, we had a mogul competition over in the Snow Bowl, and you know, we saw a lot of first-class skiers, and they were really good. And we worked with like Phil Mayer and his brother, and I was on the ski patrol then, so it was It was great. It was really exciting. And, you know, and
during that same thing, the at the peak of the celebration and such of the World Cup, there was a bomb scare in the baseline. There was a bomb in the baseline.
Right, I remember that, yeah.
And so, of course, they radioed us, and we gathered all our guys together and searched the base lodge, and half scared and half not.
Yeah.
But in those days, that was the thing they did, is put a bomb somewhere, you know, and we had to evacuate the base lodge and get everybody away, you know. And it obviously turned out to be non-existent.
False. But yeah.
Just the idea of it was quite, quite unnerving.
Yeah.
And we had a, I don't know, there were so many things that that took place during those years. It's kind of hard to
pinpoint anyone.
One that was outstanding.
You know,
and we
the chicken dance.
Chicken dance.
Yeah,
what was the chicken dance?
The Austrian chicken dancing.
We chicken danced a lot.
Clap, 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 flap, flap, flap.
Was that with the Stratton Mountain Boys playing?
Yeah, and yes.
And we drank hot glue vine.
Glue vine.
That was not real tasty, but you kind of got used to it. It was a hot wine.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm. Huh. Well, what else? We had some very difficult accidents, so to speak, and that was again primarily because of growing pains of the ski industry and such.
Yeah, yeah.
We bought one of these fancy new snow machines that was called a Thiokol. It was made out in Salt Lake City, and it was wonderful because it replaced the old snowcats with the four different pods they had on them, and this machine really worked really very good. And one of the operators of this new snow machine pulled up in the middle of the North American on the top of the mountain to talk with one of the guys in one of the other machines, and he shut the thing off, and they were gabbing away, and all of a sudden the machine started to go. Well, they neglected to make the machine so that you could start it if it was in gear or out of gear.
Mm.
And this thing, the machine would not start, so he could not control it. It was all hydraulic control.
Yeah.
And the thing went, this North American trail was one of the steeper ones on the mountain.
Oh.
And it went screaming down, and the back end of it had a thing that went down. They called a compactor blade, and the operator of the machine decided to jump out, so he jumped out, and his head caught the compactor bar. Did a frightful tune on him, but the machine then went careening down through and hit one of the big
towers,
birch trees.
Oh,
just
yeah.
Missed the tower, hit it a little, but not enough to hurt it. But right by the birch tree were all the control wires on the ground. They just laid them on the ground back then, and it split all the control wires, so we had no telephone communication.
Oh.
The lift was down. The guy was in the middle of North America, and it was a frightful calamity trying to get everything. We had to evacuate the lift, and we had to get the engine man off the mountain. And
I can't imagine.
That was a pretty big highlight right there.
Yeah.
And that guy today is over in Wardsboro, has his own business. Bob Arms is his name. Nice guy. And he was in bad shape for quite a while.
Wow.
It's a couple of the very interesting things that happened over there.
Yeah. The safety on the mountain is so much better now. The ski
and
ski accidents. I mean, the equipment that we have today is so
very
much better.
Tech.
Oh,
yeah.
You see less and less trouble like that.
Some of the gruesome things that happened. I don't know if that's something you want me to say anything about.
Oh, sure. Bring it on.
This was a couple that had a very nice home on the mountain, Tom and Joanne Head. And Tom was an avid skier and a very fast. He raced a lot. I mean, this is a guy that's probably, at that time, was probably 40, 45 years old. And his wife, a very pretty lady, and she was always trying to keep up with him. Well, they came down the mountain, and at that time they called the What was that little shoe over there on the...
Snowball.
Huh?
Snowball?
No, that wasn't the snowball. I forget, but anyways, they skied on down by that lift, and it was a long run out. The run out means that you just come down the steep part of the mountain, and then it's rather flat, then go back over to the main part of the mountain. And they were really going fast when they come down there and hit that run out. And he navigated it fine, but the ruts were a little deep, and she hit it, and the ruts made her come on, you know, kind of sag around, and she finally fell over, and she hit a fence that was erected on 4x4 posts, which, you know, 4x4 posts, it's a pretty good-sized post. And she broke that 4x4 post into a section about that long, with her chest up through here. She had ribs coming out the front and ribs coming out the back. And
so you saw it all.
Oh, man.
You were on the front line.
She was very, very... Critically, she was dead when we got her to the hospital. But we got her going again, and she's still alive today. Mm. And my wife took a little bit of unlikely, you know, because every time she'd see me, she'd wrap her arm around me.
Give you a big hug.
And Mother didn't like that too well. But anyway.
Well, speaking of that, the two of you have been married, what?
65 years.
That is just an amazing testament.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, yeah.
After they went to Maryland to get married, then I came along.
Yeah, and you've all been such a valuable part of this community. What wisdom can you share with us? What do you attribute your wonderful lives to? Is there any little secret that worked for you guys?
Well, it's interesting because we kind of navigated through life on the same track. I mean, obviously I did a lot of work different than what Ruthie did, but we a lot of our life was together, like on the mountain and that sort of thing. That was good fun, but I did a lot of the work that wasn't involved with all of us together. But we all remembered being together, and we stuck together, you know. And so when we bought this old house, I was fortunate to be able to give Susie some property on the same property, and she and her husband and son have been on that, so we're all still close by.
Yes, yeah.
Really happy about that.
I was just going to show, I remembered we had this lovely pair of skis that I think you got for your 80th birthday, and I thought we should just show them. Maybe I can grab them.
Where'd they go?
So this is a wonderful, I'm just going to lay these over your lap, a wonderful set of skis that were given to you for your 80th birthday, and everybody who was here signed them.
Yeah.
And I think it's just a wonderful testament to you.
It's very interesting. They figured they were going to have a pretty hard time fooling me, but they did. They did it very well. They put out an invitation in the mail to get together at the Stratton Club for King Wright, whom was the president of the clinic at that time.
Uh-huh.
And we were going to have a big party for King Wright. I'm like, whoa, that sounds like fun. And so Ruthie and I got there, and we walked up the walk at the parking lot with Donnie Davison, who was one of the lads that worked for me years ago up there.
And Candy.
And Candy, right. And we had a good chat, and I said, boy, the King's got a lot of people coming out. The place was packed. And I walked in, and he said, you better sign the skis. I said, oh, okay, but I don't think I did. Somebody else hollered at me, and we went in, and they hollered, surprise, I about fainted. I couldn't believe it.
Well, his birthday was on Friday, and he was all mad because
there was no celebration.
He figured somebody ought to do something for his 80th birthday. I said, I'm really sorry, Dad. So we just went to a friend's
poor
house
Casey.
For dinner. We gave him his presents and the whole nine yards.
You pulled it over
on
him.
And he says to Mom, I think somebody ought to do something for me.
Little did you know.
I said, you don't get to be 80 every day.
So yeah. We were at the Stratton Club, and we had a wonderful time. It's a beautiful facility. And
oh, it was.
So look out, when you turn 90, you'll be.
Oh. Yeah, I don't know where we'll go then.
Never make that.
Casey, one of the things that I sort of brushed over was you had mentioned learning to ski at Bromley and a very distinct sort of style and technique there. And then when these Austrians came to the area, they were promoting a very different technique. Tell me a little bit about what the differences were, what that was like.
Well, I think Susie can tell you better than I. She was more into the basics of teaching and the way the skiing turned out, don't you think?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, there was a lot of upper body movement, you know. I don't know if you've seen any old skiing movies, but their bodies were literally sort of swaying back and forth, moving, rotation, as Dad said, to get the ski to turn. And which was basically a waste of time, because when the Austrians came, and our leader of the ski school, Emil Henrich, who were all fantastic skiers, they showed us that you didn't have to have a lot of movement. It's basically shifting your weight from one foot to the other with your weight on the front part of the ski will turn your ski so that you're on the edge of the ski. And I don't know if they learned that skiing in Austria, which is probably a lot steeper than what we have here, or they were taught that, but we taught that technique, and it was much easier for a person to think about basically transferring your weight from one foot to the other than all this rotation, movement, arms flailing.
Much more subtle.
Yeah, so you basically were stepping from one ski to the other.
Mm-hmm.
And now and back then, you were taught to keep your skis right tight together.
Mm-hmm.
That was the form.
Yes.
You know, very tight
yeah.
together. And arms out a little, you know, mm-hmm. kind of. And now it's gotten all different. Now there's the new technique of the wide skis.
Right.
The skis aren't tight together anymore.
Right.
There's still very little movement. You'll see a really good skier that doesn't move a lot.
I love watching skiers on the mountain, and there's some people that still ski with
still
tight
do.
Skis.
Lots of people do. That's
and
what
just
we were taught.
So it's like ballet.
Yeah,
so
it's like
beautiful.
Ballet.
Yeah.
You know, I'm thinking about it. The only lessons I ever had skiing, and I love to ski. I try to get out almost once a week during the winter. I do the GISP ski program with
mm-hmm.
the kids,
mm.
and the only instruction I ever had was from Ruthie. So I owe it all to Ruthie.
She knew
Thank
a lot,
you.
That's for sure.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah.
But I think that's basically the techniques that have changed, and I don't think there's much change now. It's pretty basic, you know. When you teach someone to ski, pretty much is the weight change from one foot to the other.
And can you still get out skiing a little bit, or?
I have not skied in 5 years.
Yeah.
I just got a new knee, and I'm hoping next winter I'll be able to try it again.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah.
Yeah.
John, we used to have kind of a standing joke between Ruthie and myself on the fact that, well, Ruthie, you teach them to ski, and when they fail, I bring them down.
Luckily, I never needed your knock on wood. Never
then
needed.
Then they'll meet the family and probably go there for cocktails.
Right. Yeah. Covered all the bases.
Yeah.
yeah.
Well, thank you so much, all of you, for sharing these stories. We could go on and on and on.
Well,
this
thank
is
you,
always
John.
The case, but it's
you.
Been a pleasure to talk with you and. And thank you for opening your home up. Wara bara di turi ro na turi du ti turi bie bam bum bam bam du.